July 1st is a challenge and an opportunity, primarily for G-codes. So in Medicare's requirement for utilizing G-codes, the therapist has a job on evaluation, for example, of a patient in order to determine what's their primary functional limitation. Their primary functional limitation needs to be described by one of the G-code available numeric representations, so there's numbers associated with the different categories, and the therapist has to decide for this individual patient, what is your primary limiter right now? So you could have a patient with a shoulder and a knee condition, let's say, for example, and they have issues in lifting and carrying, but they also have issues in mobility. You have to choose the primary limiter right now. And so once you've chosen that, that's your G-code that you're determining for this patient. And besides reporting that G-code, which you need to do, you have to tell Medicare also how severely limited, restricted are they for that issue. So let's say we chose lifting and carrying. How restricted are they in lifting and carrying? And so you do that, you have to make a choice about that, and we can talk about that in a second. And then you have to say, where do I think they'll be at discharge? So just like we do typically in prognosis with patients on eval, we say, okay, at discharge, I think you could recover so much that you're this much limited. And that would be your goal code for that G-code and the severity modifier that reflects how much limitation you think they'll have at that time period. So that's what a physical therapist needs to determine. So how do we determine that? We have really three major things that factor into determining what our primary limiters are and how to describe them to Medicare with these severity modifiers. So we have functional information or functional outcome measures. They're really in two categories. One category is self-report, and those are things that people talk about, the DASH, the disabilities of the arm, shoulder, hand, Oswestry low back disability index, neck disability index, and there's many others. Those really are self-report. The patient is answering questions about how they're functioning and performing. The second one is functional performance measures. Those are things that we're measuring in the clinic ourselves, such as distance walked in a certain time, number of times rising and lowering from a chair, for example, in a set period of time. So those are really performance-based measures. I'm watching you perform and I'm measuring your performance. So what happens in those two categories is that we have to interpret that data. So what does that mean for us? We have to say, okay, your score was this on this self-report. And so what does that mean to me as a therapist? Well, I have to look and see, how is that described in the literature? Is that data related to risk? Because you scored on this, you're at risk for something? Or is that data used more to say it's been described as categories of disability? This would be severely disabled. This would be moderately disabled, mildly disabled. That's not uncommon with many of those measures, that they have that kind of a description. Or one example could be 0 to 100 scale, where 100% is 100% impaired and 0 is no impairment. There's no real anchors in between. That's all we know. So you're somewhere between no impairment and 100% impairment. That it can be interpreted by the therapist to say, what does this mean to me? So we have to go on what the literature suggests is the interpretation of that scale. Then we can add in a performance-based measure that we actually saw, and that also has to be interpreted. So how do we do that? We can compare it to age-match norms. So if a person of the same age and same sex, sometimes they're divided also by male and female, would perform at this distance or this speed or this time, then I can compare how close my patient is to that normative person, or what would their peers be performing like. I can also compare it to people in their own population, so a subpopulation, like patients with Parkinson's. So where is my patient performing based on how patients with Parkinson's perform on this measure? Or conversely, I can interpret it as a risk. So if you are this slow at doing something, or slower, then you're at risk for falls, a high risk for falls. If you're this slow, you're a medium risk for falls. So I have important information in that column that I can use to say, wow, this is telling me this patient is pretty far from their age match peers, and that some of these measures are interpreted as severely disabled. I take that information and then I move on to my evaluation like we typically do and collect my clinical data. Range of motion, strength, balance screening, other types of coordination, other types of measures that we typically do in an evaluation, and I interpret all that data. How restricted is their strength? How restricted is their range? How limited are they in their coordination? And then I've got some clinical data that I'm used to collecting and interpreting on, you know, that person seems worse off because they not only have a range restriction, but they have 50% strength loss. This person has a range restriction and 10% strength loss. There's a difference between those two and how impaired they are. Then I go on to a third category, which is other, but it's all the other things we have to consider: comorbidities, activity level, the function and participation that they're returning to, their resources, living alone, having a supportive spouse and family. All the things that we already factor into prognosis in physical therapy also have to be included here. The therapist takes all of that information and says, okay, in my judgment, considering how they performed on these self-report and functional measures, the data that I collected that showed how weak or strong they were and how much range loss and all the other measures that we collect, and considering the activities they have to return to, the resources available to them, the support system that they have, when I take all of that together, I now have to say they are limited to what amount. And when you do that, that's really what your severity modifiers are reflecting. And the key is that that therapist judgment is there for a reason. It's really important. When you think about therapist judgment, what you're saying is you need to consider all of these factors. And we do this in prognosis every day in the clinic. I see two patients status post total knee, and I'm telling you this one's gonna get better twice as fast as that one because there's all these comorbidities and they're not responding the same. So we're used to this, we're good at this. It's our time to shine in judgment. We have to take all that information and make a judgment based on this condition. And that is our severity modifier. And it's in percentages, you know, they're 30% limited, 40, 55. And then you look to see what category that falls in on the severity modifier scale. And it assigns two letters to that, a C something. And it tells you how much impaired you think that patient is. And that's, again, typical for what we do clinically. It's just being applied now to that specific limitation that we said was the primary one at the first time period. So we have our G code, which reflects that activity or limitation, and then how much so. And that's really the severity modifier that we attach.